Welcome to CNS Inspire series of interviews featuring conversations with people who have made commendable contribution over the years for health and development justice. Each interview of CNS Inspire series explores what went well and not so well in the past 20 years and how can we accelerate progress towards not only issue-specific goals and targets but also for integrated development of all. From small and humble beginnings come great things. This beautifully sums up the 12 to 13 years journey of rolling out and shaping India's antiretroviral therapy or ART program for people living with HIV, beginning from the first person in 2004 to over a million HIV positive people today. Dr. B.B. Rivari, widely acknowledged, especially by networks of people living with HIV, for having played an instrumental role for over a decade in forging India's ART program despite challenges and hurdles, spoke with CNS. The task ahead might be even more daunting to end AIDS by 2030. Dr. B.B. Rivari was in conversation with CNS Managing Editor Shobha Shukla. Without any further ado, let's listen to what Dr. B.B. Rivari shares with Shobha.
I am a physician, internal medicine specialist, which has now made forays into public health. It was an opportunity by chance that I came into HIV. I had joined RMN Hospital at that time, and at that time Dr. D. Sen Gupta, many of you may be knowing him, introduced me to the HIV line and asked me to accompany him to Mumbai. It was something I just went, but when I went there and I saw the discussions happening around clinical management of HIV and post-exposure prophylaxis, this introduced me more into HIV field as a technical person. Later on, I got many opportunities to go to different parts of the country for training of people on HIV. But when we went to training, we hardly had anything with us other than prophylaxis for opportunistic infection, cotrimoxazole prophylaxis. ARV was only a theory. We used to give lectures and there was nothing. But slowly as I moved around 22 states, including those in Northern India and Northeast, I started getting patients referred from there. Doctors were not seeing patients, they were not touching them. Because I had gone for training, they used to refer it to me. And slowly, gradually, I got into this treatment, HIV. Though there was an initial fear in my mind also, I should agree, about going into a specific area of action. But then I was at RML Hospital, a tertiary care hospital, and one of my teachers' unit had supported me in taking care of this patient. Real crux came when Dr. Usha Baveja from NICD referred a patient to me for treatment. We were all telling that treatment is costly, people can't afford it. And that person came to me and we gave him the same scenario. It is 30,000 rupees per month and then you have to take it lifelong. We don't want you to start and then stop it after a few months. You know these things. But that patient came back to me after precisely 1 month and told me I have sold my plot in a Northern India city for 70 lakhs and now I have 70,000 rupees every month to take care of my drugs, nutrition and everything. So that was a big motivation for us to basically, for me particularly. But then I had no idea about ARVs, I was just reading. So that put me into more reading, more discussion. There were some people already doing antiretroviral therapy in private sector. So slowly, gradually, I saw the benefit in that particular patient. The way he came to me and the way he improved in 6 months' time, and then the way we used to admit him every month for his reimbursement purposes, that motivated me. Yes, this is something, panacea which is coming into it. So antiretroviral therapy in 98 when I started him, 97 was 30,000 rupees per month and 36 capsules every day. And that person's compliance and his family support, his wife's support basically, she supported him and telling all relatives that he has got it through blood transfusion. Sarji, that was the usual way. You cannot tell and get discriminated and society will have their own issues. So the motivation of that person and that family, particularly his wife, motivated me. As a clinician, yes, I should take care. So I established a HIV clinic at RML. Those days, national program was not providing treatment. So I started a HIV clinic on Monday afternoons and I started getting patients from here and there. But again, there was frustration. There was frustration, people not being able to afford, difficulty in getting the drugs, very costly, toxic, side effects. So just 5% of my patient, 1100, 1200 patient could get these drugs. So, but then me and some of my colleagues, I will not say alone, started talking to NACO on providing these drugs. You have to provide these drugs. We became sort of activist, and we had problems also. When you become activist, you have problem also. But there was good support from NACO, and ultimately in line with WHO 3x5 initiative, NACO also started that free treatment program. And at that time, I got an opportunity to get associated. Since I was in Delhi, I was treating patients already, working with NACO on technical matters. I had developed a technical module on training of doctors for NACO while being in a hospital. So I moved to NACO. It was a very brief, short period that I'll move and then we'll set up a system and I'll come back. But a big inspiration, when you ask me, was every month I used to compile number of patients on ART. And it was a big, big incentive for me, encouragement for me to see that graph rising. I used to make a PowerPoint and Excel sheet, and that increase in the number was a big motive. That, okay, now instead of one patient, two patients, I am helping my patient. So I used to do my clinic also initially for 3 days and then NACO, and then slowly, gradually, I got fully into HIV care. If I look back from 2005 till now, it has been a very, very satisfying journey. In fact, I wrote a book for NACO, The Journey of ART Program in India, which is available on NACO website. It has been a big, big achievement that we have been able to make as a team with the government and WHO support. There has been a lot of support from WHO India on basically scale up. That has been a very focused support given by WHO. One of the incentive for patient to get tested is provision of treatment. This was a game changer. When we say tipping point in National AIDS Control Program is provision of free ART. Earlier than that, if you get tested, you are positive, you have nothing to offer. Now we had something to offer. Another very game changer has been a strategy we evolved on scaling up ART. Basically, it was an evidence-based scale-up. Like, we went to clients, saw their perspectives, we went to providers, got their perspectives. We did a study called Client and Provider Perspective on HIV, which told us that 32% of patients default on treatment because of long distance to travel. Another 36% default because of money they have to spend on traveling. So we went back, looked into our strategy, decentralized ART to link ART center, which are nearer to center. We actually went and talked to railways, and even now we get a 50% discount on railway travel when you come for ART. So, and another point which I really remember is a community involvement. Community has been very supportive. We have worked with them. Being a clinician, and while I was scaling up, I was doing my clinic also. I was seeing patients also. So based on that, we got feeling from the community, what they require, what are their perspective, what they think is doable, and what they think what NACO is doing is not really reaching them. That was a big support to us. So I will say some of the game changers in NACP has been provision of ART, decentralization on need-based basis, geographically need, setting up of ART centers. Then another point was community involvement. Even in our technical guidelines discussions, when we move from 350 to 500 to more than 500, we take community into their perspective, whether asymptomatic patient will take ART or not, whether they will adhere or not. They are asymptomatic, CD4 is 600, and if they get side effects, why should they start treatment? So those kind of things have been very focused attention that we have worked with community. Also, establishment of a community care center, which have now transitioned to care and support center, has been another very important point. NACP 3 changed the outlook from hospital-based sort of community care center, 10-bedded facilities, you are aware, to a care and support center which have more issue of peer counseling, LFU tracking, and linking to social protection schemes. I remember there were discussion in around 2010 about providing nutrition to PLHIV, and there were not many operational issues. Where do you get from? How do you supply? How do you ensure PLHIV are taking? So now we actually link them to existing schemes. nutrition schemes, housing schemes, widow pension schemes, child benefit schemes, ICDS. So we link people to PLHIV through our outreach workers, which are run by, again, by NGOs who are PLHIV network, who are peer educator, who themselves are infected. So that kind of provision has worked a lot into that. So that support from community, and of course another support is Global Fund. I should appreciate the money grant that has been provided by Global Fund has been a very important step. Otherwise, without that, provision from health system budget would have been difficult in the initial. But now again government has moved. Almost 69% to 70% of funding is domestic, and Global Fund has actually phased out. One area where we focused, should have focused earlier, was viral load monitoring. There are a lot of questions here, and we have been trying, we have not been able to achieve. Now we see that it is coming in next 3-4 months, but I think we are delayed. We should admit that we are delayed in viral load monitoring, because immunological failure occurs quite late, and it is important to detect virological failure earlier. That is one area. Frankly, when I am admitting successes, we should have failures also. Another failure is basically second line uptake is low. It is 15,000. It should be more, considering that 5 to 6% patient fail. We should have 50 to 60,000 patient on second line. But we are working in these directions now, focused attention, and now we are working on early warning indicators of drug resistance, quality of care indicators. I remembered again very, very important point is the regional coordinators. You know, NACO has stated control society, which has a structure of joint director, assistant director, deputy director. But these people remain more focused on work, file work, administrative work, issuing orders. The need was basically move into field. People who just remain in the field, go to AIT center, not point out their mistake, but point out their gaps, solve them there and then, whatever they can then mentor them. So monitoring, which was associated with mentoring, was came through regional coordinators. And I would like to say that Dr. Sujata Rao, who was Director General NACO at that time, initiated this concept, and it has been carried forward by all people. There are sometimes questions, why do you need special people in ART? But these regional coordinators have contributed a lot to quality of the program. We have specific now quality indicators, that these indicators how the centers are performing.
Now, in light of the SDGs which are there, what are some doable, measurable, and specific actions you could recommend which will bring us achieve that?
Very right. We have committed to community, to the world, and to ourselves that we have to end AIDS epidemic by 2030 and achieve SDG 3. We achieved MDG 6 very well, so we can achieve SDG 3 also. That gives us the confidence. Now, what are the specific measurable? One is very important, as I said in the morning, treat all recommendations need to be followed. Any PLHIV is detected positive must get started on treatment. It not only benefits him, it prevents transmission. So reduction in new infection is possible if we adopt treat all. That is one. We have agreed in principle, but now we need to. That is a landmark recommendation coming from WHO. Second is basically we need to monitor them closely through viral load, detect the failure early. More important is now our coverage is 43%. Global coverage of ART is only 57% out of 26 million requiring ART, 17 million are on ART. Point is we need to detect them. Where are these people? Out of 21 lakh in India, 14 lakh are detected. Where are these? So we need to adopt newer testing strategies. New testing strategy includes community-based testing, self-testing, scaling up in private sector, some of these provider-initiated testing and counseling, more focused. So with based on WHO guidelines, now we are formulating on Indian guidelines basically on how to move ahead. Another important concept is, which has not taken off in India but is very important, is looking at key populations from where our infections are coming. Why not have a provision for pre-exposure prophylaxis? Of course, there are issues with pre-exposure prophylaxis. Issues could be adherence, toxicity, uptake, acceptance. If you see studies related to this, hypergay study, partner study, 90%, more than 90%, provided you are adherent, if you take it regularly. So this is one area where we need to work. I feel treating all, increasing our detection, moving towards provision of PrEP, and of course 90-90-90 targets, which are 2020 targets, we should be able to achieve that.
Looking back at your own life, what have been the very proud moments for you? There must have been many proud moments, but some which reach you, some very proud incidents.
The best moment in my life are when I get an appreciation from a PLHIV. On 10 years of journey of ART, when we had a function, this was a function totally done by civil society. And on that day, I got a booklet presented by Network in National Coalition of Positive People of India, Manoj Pardesi, Daksha Patel and other people, all together. They collected in one last 3 months quotes from different people. Different director generals, this thing, that thing, people, other PLHIV, their own quotes from my juniors, my seniors, and they presented that to me in form of a booklet. I think that is the best souvenir I have got in my life. And being a clinician, best satisfaction is when you see people responding to your treatment. And here it is not 1, 2, or 10, these are in lakhs. Of course, it is a teamwork, but I do get credit many times being the team leader, but it is a teamwork, great teamwork, very, very satisfying. I think I would like to say it was a dream which I have lived fully. In 2004 or 1996, it was a dream. I fully lived a dream, and now again, but I am now in another focus, being with WHO, now Southeast Asia Regional Office. I think I want to extend this experience to 11 countries in Southeast Asia. That is my prime responsibility now as HIV focal person with the WHO CRO.
We were listening to Dr. B.B. Rivari, Senior HIV/AIDS Focal Point at the World Health Organization Southeast Asia Regional Office. He was in conversation with CNS Managing Editor Shobha Shukla. This interview is part of CNS Inspire series of interviews featuring conversations with people who have made commendable contribution over the years for development justice. Each interview of CNS Inspire series explores what went well and not so well in the past 10-20 years and how can we accelerate progress towards not only issue-specific goals and targets, but also for integrated development of all. For more details, be welcome to check out our website www.citizen-news.org or follow us on Twitter at @CNS_health. Thanks for listening and stay tuned for our next episode of CNS Inspire series.